Welcome to our Sunday morning worship service.
Hallelujah, Christ arose, hey? That's just such wonderful news. Well, let's join together in our call to worship as we call ourselves into the presence of God for this time of worship. Risen Christ, we come to you seeking signs of the resurrection, signs of new life. We know you have called us to be witnesses to your love and grace and to share it with everyone we meet, but we don't always know how to do it. Open your words to us this day that we may hear your voice, understand your message, and take it out into the world. As we worship together, may we accept the challenge to live fully in your love as we embrace the truth that new life really is rising among us. Amen. And now as we sing Jesus Love Me together, I would invite all the children and those young at heart to come up. Well, good morning, boys and girls.
Good morning.
Hey, way to go. How are you doing this morning?
Good.
I have a question for you. Do you like puzzles?
Yes.
Yeah? What kind? Any kind of puzzles? Well, I especially like word puzzles. You know those word searches where the words go up and down and sometimes diagonally and across and you got to make a circle around it to find the word. Have you ever worked that kind of puzzle? And sometimes you look and you look and you look and you can't find the word. Or maybe you do a where's Waldo? And you have to find the little pictures in there. And sometimes we can just look and look and not find it, right? And then maybe we'll go away and we'll come back. And then, boom, there it is right in front of us. And we wonder, why in the world could I not see that before? Has that ever happened to you? Yeah. Happens to me a lot. So I have a little puzzle I brought today. It's sort of like a word puzzle. So it's a picture, and I'm going to show it to all of you. But if you get the answer right away, don't say it, okay? Just raise your hand, okay? So I'm going to show it to you now and see if you can find the hidden word, okay? Everybody want to see? Okay, one's got it. Well, raise your hand. Yeah? Any more? You need to look longer over here. See it yet?
Yeah.
Okay, raise your hand. Pretty good. You guys can look too. I don't know if you can see this or not. See it? Okay, those of you that have your hands up, what does it say?
Jesus.
Jesus. You see it? Yeah, it says Jesus right there in there. You don't see it? Look at the white part. Very good. At the bottom it says, look at the light. So look at the white, and it'll pop right out at you, huh? Yeah. Yeah. That's pretty cool, isn't it? Look at the white. J, E. You see it?
Doesn't pop out.
Doesn't pop out. Okay. So anyway, the reason I did this is that sometimes Jesus can be a real puzzle to us, and we don't understand him very well. Okay, well, now we're going to tell the other story, okay? Sometimes Jesus is a puzzle to us. And he was to the disciples, too. You know, after his resurrection, he came to visit them. And they really didn't believe that it was him. They couldn't see him the way he wanted them to see. In fact, some of them thought he was a ghost. Can you imagine thinking Jesus was a ghost after the resurrection? So Jesus kind of knew that, and he knew they were kind of freaked out and scared. So he said, look at my hands. Look at my feet. You see the holes in there from when they crucified me? And they looked, wow, maybe it is you. He said, touch me. Look, touch me. You can't touch a ghost. And they would see the flesh and the bones of Jesus. Some of them still couldn't see. So he said, okay, does anybody have anything to eat around here? Well, one of the disciples had a piece of fish, so they gave it to him. Ate it. And he said, now ghosts don't eat, do they? And then they went, okay, it must be you. And he said, it is me. And I told you that all of this was going to happen. I told you that I would have to suffer. I told you that they would kill me and I would have to die and go into the tomb and that I would rise in 3 days. All of this because God wanted everybody to know that they are forgiven and that they are loved and that God has experienced everything through Jesus that we have experienced. And then he said, I want you to go out and tell everybody that. Tell them how much God loves them. Tell them how wonderful God thinks they are, every single person. And then he did one more thing just to prove his point. He opened the scriptures. He said, I open the scriptures to your hearts and mind. Who knows what scripture is? Yeah, what scripture?
I'm bloody.
Well, go get fixed. Who knows what scripture is? Anyone? Okay, scripture is our Bible. We call our Bible sometimes the words inside of that scripture. And Jesus opened their eyes so that they could understand it. And so they could read his stories and know what he meant. Because sometimes they're kind of like a puzzle. And we have to ask Jesus to help us. So remember that when you go to Sunday school or when you're at home this week and maybe you look at a Bible story and have Jesus help you to understand it. And then go tell somebody how much God loves them. Okay? All right, let's pray. Our Father, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Okay.
Please join me in the second verse of Jesus Loves Me. Jesus loves me still today, walking with me on my way, wanting as a friend to give light and love to all who live. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Today's gospel is from Luke chapter 24. While they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Say I lost my faith in science and progress. You could say I lost my belief in the Holy Church. You could say I lost my sense of direction. Could say all of this and worse, but if I ever lose my faith in you, there'd be nothing left for me to do. Some would say I was a lost man in a lost world. Say I lost my faith in the people on TV. You could say I lost my belief in our politicians. They all seem like game show hosts to me. Thank you.
pray with me, please. God of peace and all things good, we come before you this morning still amazed at the miracle of your resurrection. And truth be told, still daunted of your challenge to us to carry your message into the world. We know, Lord, that you are the author of patience and wisdom, and that there is nothing for us to be frightened of, because you wouldn't ask us to do something that we're not capable of. Still, Lord, we ask that you be near us this day, that you open the scriptures to our understanding too, just as you did for your first disciples. Help us to open our hearts and our minds to any new lessons that you might have for us this day, so that when we go out in the world and we share the good news about you, we might say what you want us to say rather than what we think we should say. We pray this in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. This morning's text is Luke's version of the appearance of Jesus to the disciples after the resurrection. It is quite different from what we heard from the Gospel of Mark last week. There we heard Jesus scold the disciples for their lack of understanding and faith and their stubbornness because they still refused to believe that what he had told them would happen actually did happen. Plus, they had already been told by Mary Magdalene and a couple of disciples that Jesus had met up with along as they were walking along the countryside. But today we have that more familiar, comfortable sounding Jesus for us. The one who enters into the room of a bunch of scared disciples with those beautiful words, "Peace be with you." He is more patient in helping them understand that it really is him standing there. He helps them through their fears and doubts by showing them his hands and feet, by telling them to actually touch him, and then finally asks for something to eat. And then, just as in Mark and the other Gospels as well, he commissions them to carry out his message into the world. But then Luke adds this one more beautiful thing. He tells us that Jesus opened up the scriptures so that they can understand them. Can you imagine what a gift that must have been? All through their time with Jesus, they had sought to understand, but they really didn't. They didn't understand the parables. They didn't understand the miracles. They didn't understand why Jesus had to be crucified. My guess is that deep down, they really didn't even understand him. Even though they had had firsthand experience with him, they were unable to grasp the depth and the purpose of his ministry. Even though he had repeatedly told them that the scriptures would be fulfilled by his life and death and resurrection, they had still not been able to take it in. Part of it was because they were so focused on what they wanted to happen, as opposed to what God wanted to happen. They had perceived Jesus through the lens of their own agenda, which was to be rescued from the occupation and the oppression of the Roman Empire. But you see, God had a different and, frankly, much larger plan. That was the reconciliation of the entire world. Yeah, the truth still hadn't been fully received. And if the truth of God's message was going to find its way into the world, well then, those messengers need to have a big handle on it. So Jesus opened their minds to the full magnitude of God's plans and purposes. He was gentle and compassionate in his approach, but the lesson that he was teaching, well, that was profound. Effectively, he was saying to them, it's time to get up out of your grief. It's time to put your fear behind you. There's work to be done. Now it's time to open your minds, because I am going to reveal the mysteries of the truth to you so that you can understand. I am sending power to you, And then I want you to go on and continue the work that I have started. It's all part of God's plan and purpose. Can you see that now? This is what I've been trying to tell you for the last 3 years, Jesus might have said. See how the scriptures have been fulfilled? It's time for you to get started right here, right now, in this place where you thought you had lost that last flicker of hope. This place where you deserted me and failed me and ran away in fear. But that's all in the past now. Go and tell people that I have risen just as the scripture said I would, and that God is faithful, and that forgiveness is for everyone. But do it in my name, in the way that I would do it. That means following God's agenda, not your own. That means building community among yourselves and modeling mercy and compassion and love so that everyone will know what it means to be forgiven. And then everyone will turn their eyes toward our God and know that they are loved. Well, history tells us that they were able to accomplish their task. History also tells us that they were not the only ones. They were the first witnesses, yes. But as their community grew, Christianity continued to spread throughout the world at an incredible pace. You and I are part of that same community. We call it the body of Christ. 2 weeks out from Easter, we too stand in that post-resurrection moment, just like the disciples did that day. And we too struggle with the meaning of it all and trying to grasp the idea that Jesus really is alive. As Easter people, we say he's alive. But do we really believe that? Do we really believe that Jesus is actively at work out in the world as well as in each of us? It's an important question, because if we're going to embrace the reality that Jesus is alive and call ourselves his disciples, we have a job to do, and that is to continue to spread Jesus' message of forgiveness and God's desire for relationship with all of humanity. Why? Because Christianity is not growing like it used to. The movement has slowed down quite a bit, and it is up to us to take the pace up again. But before we can share that message with any kind of conviction and integrity, we need to let Jesus open our mind to the understanding of the Word of God. That means we have to believe in his presence with us at this very moment. You can't have a relationship with a dead person. If Jesus is only past tense for us, then so are the scriptures. And they will have absolutely no relevance to our everyday living. Without an active and growing relationship with Christ, our faith becomes nothing more than a habit. We come to church, we go through the motions, we participate in the rituals, we do what's required of us, but we don't expect anything to come from it, other than perhaps an answer to some of our prayers. We don't expect any real change, either within ourselves or out into the world. We don't anticipate newness, at least not in our time. Instead, newness has taken something that has gone into a future time, a future place after we die. Then we'll experience it. Well, if we live with that kind of attitude, we develop a mindset that the problems of the world are not ours. And even if they were, we couldn't do anything about it anyway. And you know, when you stop to think about it, that's where the disciples were that morning that Jesus came to visit. They could not believe that their world would ever be anything different, especially after the crucifixion. In that moment, everything seemed painfully futile again. Life would return to the way it was. The challenge to the power systems that they had tried, that saw on so many occasions, had failed. And no one would ever be able to overcome it. Oh, they might have a few meager victories along the way, but there was no hope for real and lasting change. The evils of life would always be with them. They couldn't overcome, the evils couldn't be overcome by good because the good was dead. But Jesus' resurrection showed them otherwise. And his appearance to them convinced them otherwise. And thus they were able to carry out the commission. That's true for us too. When Jesus is alive in us, new insights will continually come, new attitudes and behaviors will continually unfold for us. The disciples started a good work, but it is not done. And it won't be done until the kingdom does fully come. Our work today is the same as it was for those first disciples. We are the witnesses now. We are the disciples of this generation. And we need to understand the foundation of truth that lies within our holy scriptures. And sadly, so much of our scripture has been misinterpreted, misapplied, and misused because of a lack of understanding. And so much harm has come from that. Well, recently, apropos of nothing, I got a new insight on the third commandment, the one that talks about you shall not take the name of your God in vain. Well, I used to think that it simply meant don't swear. Well, little did I know how narrow and small that interpretation was. Now, I don't know where or why that new thought came to me, but it just popped into my brain suddenly that taking God's name in vain was so much more than combining it with a four-letter word when you stub your toe in the middle of the night. Taking God's name in vain means using God to further our own agenda, as opposed to God's agenda. It is a manipulation of God and a misappropriation of God's view of the world. Think of the disasters that were brought on by the Crusades and the Spanish Inquisition, all in the name of God. Think of the injustice and harm caused to the LGBTQ community, all in the name of God. Think of the ethnic cleansing that has gone on throughout the world, all in the name of God. Think of slavery and Jim Crow laws and the subservience of women, all in the name of God. But you see, God's kingdom is so different. In God's kingdom, every single person has value and is deserving of love. In God's kingdom, every single person is chosen. No one is left out because of race or religion or sexual orientation or nationality or looks or abilities. In God's kingdom, goodness overcomes evil, not killing. In God's kingdom, mercy and forgiveness are the fruits of confession, not condemnation and punishment. In God's kingdom, there is always enough for everyone. There's enough for everyone to have access to the basic rights of shelter and food and water and education and health care. That's not saved just for those who can afford it. When God's name or God's word is misused, people are hurt and often abused, and sometimes they even die. That's why it is so important to grapple with our sacred text, to keep it alive and relevant, and to remind ourselves often of the message Jesus told us to proclaim and the way he asked us to proclaim it. To understand the scriptures, the first thing we need to do is to commit to reading and studying them. Many of us don't. Preferably, that reading and study will be done in community and with the input of scholars and theologians who have given their lifetimes to sifting through the various languages and the context of the biblical narrative. You and I simply don't have enough command of Hebrew and Greek and Aramaic and Latin to make our own interpretations. Then we need to have open minds and teachable spirits. It may be that we will have to unlearn some of those things that we were taught when we were younger and be able to take on a new idea and to make room for new insights that may come our way. And finally, and most importantly, we need to engage them with the resurrected Jesus right by our side so that we can look at them through his eyes and his heart. To come to the scriptures with the eyes of Jesus means to approach them through the lens of love. Remember what he said after answering the question about what is the greatest commandment? You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your mind and all your soul, and you shall love your neighbors as yourself. And then he added a statement, on all the law and all the words of the prophets hangs this commandment, love. And then at the Last Supper, he gave the disciples a new commandment to love other people as they had been loved. And then how about the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus said, you have heard it said that you are to love your neighbor and hate your enemies, but I say to you, love even your enemies. Coming to Scripture with Jesus' eyes means we bring the lens of peace and nonviolence. Remember his command at the time of his arrest? Put your sword away, back in its place, for those who live by the sword will die by the sword. And again, on the Sermon on the Mount, he said, you've heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, but I say to you, do not resist an evildoer. If anyone strikes you on the right cheek, then turn the other one also. Coming to Scripture with Jesus' eyes means that we also come with the lens of forgiveness and healing. Again, listen to his words from the Sermon on the Mount. When you are offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that a brother or sister has something against you, then leave your gift and go and be reconciled. Then come back and offer your gift. If we are to understand the depth of meaning of the Scriptures, what they say about God, what they say about life, what they say about faith and truth, what they say about the human condition, then we have to let Jesus lead the way. The Bible has many, many parts that are extremely difficult to understand, especially in the Old Testament. Jesus came with a new teaching, a new authority, a new interpretation. Our challenge is to scrutinize through those tough passages with lenses of love and peace and forgiveness, and then listen for the wisdom that Jesus has to offer us. With Jesus at our side, we have the opportunity to find wholeness. Why? Because when he healed, he didn't just heal the ailment that was presented to him. Instead, he restored the whole person physically, emotionally, and spiritually. When we keep Jesus at our side, we have the opportunity to learn what it really means, to turn our lives over to God and to live our lives the way God is asking us and calling us to do rather than the way we might want to do. But most important, when we keep the living, resurrected Jesus at our side, we have the opportunity to be changed and commissioned every time we come to the Bible. Christianity is not a religion that sits still. The resurrection is not some beautiful spiritual experience that we are to bask in for a time. It is the ultimate demonstration of God's power and love and desire for all of humankind to come together in unity. It is a mandate for peace, a call to lay aside our differences and to see one another as the precious children of God that we are. Jesus did not tell the world to go to church. Jesus told the church to go to the world. We learn the truth of Scripture by studying it. We learn the truth of love and forgiveness by sharing it. And we learn the truth that will set us free by sharing it as well. There's someone in your life today that needs to know that. Go and tell them. God bless you.
Please look at page 5 of your bulletin for prayer concerns and keep these people in your prayer for this next week. May this time of worship, reflection, and celebration be a worthy response to Christ's love and sacrifice for us. Let us take a moment in silent prayer. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, the light of your love shines on, illuminating the places where you are present. As the bewildered disciples pondered the stories of your appearance, You penetrated the darkness of their fear and doubt with your word of peace. You showed them the marks of evil placed on your hands and feet. You opened their minds to understand why you had to die to defeat such evil and death. Open our hearts and minds to receive you, so that through understanding, you may live more richly in the present. Through seeing with understanding, we may actively shape the future. And through anticipating with understanding, we may know the joy of your coming kingdom. We pray for all those in special need in this congregation and community. We pray for all those who live with hunger and homelessness, for all whom struggle with guilt, mental illness, abuse, poverty, or illness. God, we pray for your spirit of healing and loving support for all the days ahead. Bring to us the sense of your living presence as we go into this new week. Renew in us the faith you want us to have, the faith that is not afraid to reach out in your name and to share the treasure you have given us. And finally, we thank you for loving us, for living in this world for us, for showing us who God is, for reminding us that the Holy Spirit will always be with us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. We now come to this moment in our worship where we give back to God. As you know, the ministries of this church and of the UCC would not be possible without your financial support. This is one way that we are able to carry out God's purpose in our ministries together. So may we give not out of obligation, but in hope for what the gifts can do. The ushers may come forward.
Thank you.
Gracious God, enable us to use these offerings to strengthen the body of Christ, both in this local church and in the greater church in all its settings. Give us continued courage to speak prophetically, act boldly, and respond compassionately, both in this place and beyond the safety of our doors. Amen. The closing song is number 293 in our hymnal, Christ is Risen, Shout Hosanna.
Christ is risen, shout Hosanna, celebrate this day of days. Christ is risen, hush in wonder, all creation is amazed. In the desert, all surrounding, sea has spreading, tree has grown. Healing leaves of grace abounding, bring a taste of love unknown. Christ is risen, raise your spirits from the caverns of despair. Walk with gladness in the morning, see what love can do and dare. Drink the wine of resurrection, not a servant, but a friend. Jesus is our strong companion, joy and peace shall never end. Christ is risen, earth and heaven, nevermore shall be the same. Break the bread of new creation, where the world is still in pain. Tell its grim, demonic chorus, Christ is risen, get you gone. God the first and last is with us, sing Hosanna, everyone.
If you're visiting with us today, we'd like to welcome you especially and invite you to fill out a card if we can pray with you or do anything for you. Please just let us know. And also, we want to remind you that we join each hands together as we sing these last words of, we call ancient words, as a sign of our solidarity, as a sign of our community, that we all are in this together, and that it is only because we are together that we can accomplish the big things that God has asked us to do. We sing them every Sunday. Holy words, ancient words, for our journey on this earth, because they resound with God's own heart. Listen to that this week. And I have a challenge for you. Open your Bibles to the book of Psalms. Pick one psalm. Read it every single day, the same one. And see if by the end of the week, you haven't learned something new about God, about you, and about our work in this world. And now may the Son of God go before you to light your way. May the winds of God sing behind you to encourage you along. May the angels of God surround you wherever you go. And may the presence of God be with you for all of your days. Amen.
Thank you so much for worshiping with us today, and happy birthday, Pastor Scott, wherever you are. Please come on up and join us in our postlude today, My Redeemer Lives.